alone. I seek all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow, he's my comfort. In trouble, he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roam. The lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken and all my sorrows born. In temptation, he's my strong and mighty tower. Have all for him forsaken and all my titles torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna, he my hungry soul shall fill. Would you stand? Then sweeping up the glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Judy Woodruff, would you lead us in prayer, please? Have you failed in your plan of your storm-tossed life? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Are you weary and worn from its toil and strife? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Are you walking alone through the shadows dim? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Christ will comfort your heart. Put your trust in him. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Last verse. Is your soul burdened down with its load of sin? Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Throw your heart open wide. Let the Savior in. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail-scarred hand. Let's try that, just plain old G. Oh, I am resolved no longer to lean, charmed by the world delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, These have allured my sight. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee. I am resolved to go to the Savior, leaving my sin and strife. Oh, he is the true one, he is the just one, he hath the words of life. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, the greatest, high, I will come to thee. I am resolved, and who will go with me? Come, friend, without delay. Taught by the Bible, led by the Spirit, we'll walk the heavenly way. I will hasten to him, hasten so glad and free. Jesus, the greatest, highest, I will come to thee. Oh, 140 maybe. And G. And G. Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Blood applied, glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved from sin, Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in, glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There at the cross where my blood applied, glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet, cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Thank you, Robbie.
Ladies, don't forget. Don't forget Bible study tomorrow. Hey, Les, just pause it for a few moments, would you? Bible study. Oh, gosh. Hope you guys have had a great day. It's once we got home, it's good afternoon. I managed to slip a little bit of Z's in there. If you want to open your Bibles, if I'm just using a scripture kind of as a launching pad, springboard, whatever you want to call it. It's John chapter 4. Jesus with the Samaritan woman, and they're talking about worship. Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Verse 19, chapter 4. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain. You Jews say that Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. Verse 21, Jesus said, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither worship on this mountain nor Jerusalem. Worship the Father. You worship what you don't know. We worship what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is the hour when the worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is seeking such to worship Him." What is that worship that God wants? Come next Sunday morning, and I'll share with you Sunday morning, Sunday night, what that worship is. But I want to finish up what we started this morning about. Maybe instead of deviant worship, I should call it what worship is not. What worship is not. And one of the things that worship is not, that is probably very obvious, is the worship of false gods. The worship of false gods. We should not be part of that. And we want to look and we want to say, "Oh, well, no, we should not worship false gods." But anything that takes precedence, place of God, is a false god. It doesn't have to be something that you hold in your hand, something that's placed on a wall, so a figure, something, an object. It does not have to be that. However, it can be that. It can be the money, the cattle out on your hillside, a good harvest. It can be anything that takes the place of God. And when we talk about worship, we look at those vestiges of worship, the liturgy, as I said, of worship, and it doesn't have to be a particular garment or style. It is just giving that part of you that God desires. That God desires to be, and rather you pick to be in the presence of God to be somewhere else. Rather than singing and hearing God's word, you'll be over here doing, watching, participating, sitting. When you know where you should be, and you are able to be, but you choose not to be. I'm probably going to get blasted on that. But listen, if you don't hear the truth, how will you know? How will you know? So we looked at the worship of false gods. I want to look at the last three tonight, worshiping true God and worshiping true God in wrong form, worship of true God in a self-styled manner, and worshiping, I think this is the last one, is the one where I'm going to spend most of the time, worshiping God, the true God, with the wrong attitude. But I want to look at the wrong form, because when we look at the wrong form, now we move to that Exodus. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not worship what? A graven image. Worshiping God in a wrong form. But yet it goes even beyond that. You know, when you look at Moses' words that he has given in Exodus 32, he says, "The Lord God spoke to Moses, go down at once." Moses up on the mountaintop, okay? "Go down once go down at once, for your people whom you brought from the land of Egypt have now corrupted themselves. They have quickly turned aside from the way which I commanded them. They have made for themselves a molten calf and worshipped it and have sacrificed unto it and said, this is your God, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Egypt." How in the world can you go from 10 plagues, the crossing of the Red Sea and the closing of the Red Sea, the opening, crossing, closing of the Red Sea, your worst enemy vanquished, to where you're in the wilderness, the mountains rumbling and quaking and thunder and lightnings, knowing that God is up there and Moses is your representative, but he's been up there for 40 days. And they come to Aaron. We don't know what happened to this Moses. Make us a god. And Aaron, give me your earrings, your gold. He gave it to him. And I love what he told Moses. I threw it in the fire and out came this calf. Never heard of that one before. But how can all of that happen? Because what we see is the Israelites constructing the golden calf that they, and in doing so, they still thought they were worshiping the one true God. They were. But what was their problem? You cannot confine God to a calf, to a cow, to an old heifer. You cannot put God in a box. You cannot reduce him to an image. And in doing so, they corrupted their worship and concept of God. I have been in churches where you be careful when you sit down. You may need to take your shoes off because we don't want you getting manure on the rug. You know, that person's real dirty. We may need to get a trash bag for them to sit on because we don't want them to stain our pews. And you know what? We don't want the kids in our worship service because they may draw or color in our hymnals or on the wall, or they may get their gummies, whatever, on the seats. And my point is, some of those are valid and we need to take heed. But they have made their sanctuary a museum. It is to be worshipped and not the God that inhabits it. And that's why I said in our worship, it's not just in this building. I have driven one of Deward's old tractors, and it was dirty because it was hay season, and I probably didn't help it at all because I may have left some of my trash in there. Don't answer that, please. But my point is, I can worship in the cab of that dirty tractor. I can worship in the cab of my dirty Ford F-150. And you ain't going to get much dirtier than that. Or I can worship in a beautiful auditorium. You cannot reduce God down to here. And yet this is the very thing that the Israelites did. It's impossible to reduce God to a form represented by a statue or a painting. I love it. I saw Jesus in my taco. I opened up my tortilla and it was a picture of Jesus. Or, you know, I hate doing that because it always comes from the South and it makes us people in the South sound like a bunch of hicks. And we're not. Well, some of us, I'm including myself, but we look at a tree where there's a face of Jesus. How do we know? How do we know? According to what I read in Scripture, the next time anybody sees Jesus, we're all going to see Jesus that are believers. Okay? You're not going to see him in your cinnamon roll. He's not. Why would you reduce the Son of God to a cinnamon roll? Now, I know that God can reveal himself in nature. I know God can reveal himself. He spoke through a donkey. Did he not? He spoke through a burning bush. But I don't remember Moses making a burning bush sanctuary. You cannot reduce him. And we do those very things today. Years after the Sinai incident, Moses said to the assembled Israelites, first generation's passed away, the 40 years in the wilderness. Now the second generation, those were kids when Mount Sinai, if they were even born yet. And here's what he said in Deuteronomy 4. 14 to 19, he says, "And the Lord God commanded me at that time to teach you statutes and judgments that you might perform them in the land where you are going over to possess." And here's the crux of it. watch yourselves carefully, since you did not see any form on the day the Lord spoke to you at Horeb. By the way, what he's talking about is the day Moses told the people, consecrate yourself. Come forward to the mountain. And they had it area it off. But do not go up on the mountain or you will die. And God descended down. The glory of God descended down in a cloud. And there was thunderings. And there was lightning that was there. And the ground was trembling. And the people trembled. And they said, you go talk to God. We will surely die. So Moses did go up to the mountain, and the people went to their tents. And he's telling them, you were not there at Horeb that day. From the midst of the fire, the Lord God spoke to you at Horeb from the midst of the fire, lest you act corruptly and make a graven image for yourself in the form of any figure, the likeness male or female, the likeness of any animal that is on the earth, the likeness of any winged bird that flies in the sky, the likeness of anything that creeps on the ground, the likeness of any fish that is on the water below the earth. And beware lest you lift your eyes to heaven and see the sun, the moon, the stars, the host of heaven, and be drawn away and worship them and serve them, those which the Lord your God has allotted to all the peoples under the whole earth. What's he telling them? Just remember God. Don't make any graven image for any of these, and don't worship the sky and what's in them. Kind of sounds like reading your horoscope, doesn't it? When God revealed himself to the Israelites, he was unrepresented in any visible form. He came down in a cloud, in that cloud of glory. Whenever God revealed himself in the temple, when the temple was built, David gave Solomon the plan. Solomon built it. And the cloud, the smoke came in, and it was so great, no one could go in. Ezekiel talked about one of the most heartbreaking things that was in his vision when he saw the glory of the Lord. That cloud leave the temple. God did that on purpose. He did that on purpose. He does not wish to be reduced to an image, because then it's the image that we will worship. Only the incarnation of Christ was adequate to reveal God in a tangible form that we could understand, that we could behold. If you remember, Moses, show me your glory. Elisha, show me your glory. And all they got to see was what? Backside. Said, told Elisha, you cannot handle who I am. So Elisha, Moses were forced to see, but Jesus was God incarnate. No man has seen God. John wrote this in 1:18. No man has seen God at any time, only the begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father. He has explained him. John wrote those words. But then you go on and read in John's first epistle and the words that he says, that which was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have beheld, handled literally, with our hands concerning the word of life, and the life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and proclaim to you eternal life, which was with the Father and manifested, revealed, made known to us. What we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you. Nobody has seen God at any time, but there was a group of men who came really close, and that was the apostles. John was one of them. You know, one must even guard his thoughts about God, because to envision God as a gray-haired, bearded old man sitting up on a throne in heaven while that may sound fatherly or grandfatherly, while that may sound soothing, it's totally unacceptable. Because we have just, again, reduced God down to one of our elderly, and we see someone who does not have the ability, the strength, and what they used to have. And God is, may I tell you, proclaim to you, manifest to you, God is as big and as strong today as He was at creation, and that He will be at the end of all that we know here today. Idolatry does not begin with the sculptor's hammer. Idolatry begins right here in our mind, what we conceive. How one visualizes God. How do you visualize God? Quite frankly, you should. Thank you, Jerry. Exactly. He just went. You should not. Can I tell you, God is God. And they say, well, is He male or female? He's God. We want to reduce Him down, and that is idolatry. So we worship God as a false god, and we worship God in a wrong form. No visual conception of God can properly and adequately represent His eternal glory. Okay, not just the wrong form, not just a false god, but with a wrong, worship God in a self-styled manner. We make God what we want Him to be. We make God what's convenient to us. I'll give you an example. I can worship God out in the golf greens. I can worship God in my bass boat. I can worship God in a deer stand. Albeit you can. Yes, you can. But be careful what you're reducing, because what does Scripture say? Forsake not the assembly. When we have the opportunity to come together, let us come together. And you know, we have a group of men who had a self-styled manner for worship that was supreme, supremely wrong. They were called the Pharisees. They were so intent on worshiping God in the right way, they made 613 laws. And if you did not keep these 613 laws, don't worry about the Mosaic law, don't worry about, no. We have taken and refined them to this. This is the one where you wash your hands after the market. Wash your hands before a meal. Wash your feet before walking into the house. Where you could only go so many steps on the Sabbath day. Where you could not cook. Where they had so many laws. And the Pharisees tried to worship the true God with their version of worship. And not only that, if you didn't keep their version, well, you were just a sinner. You weren't doing it right. You weren't. And I love in Luke when Jesus gives the parable of the Pharisee and the pagan. Pharisee, I thank you, God, for who I am and all that I am, and that I pray, that I tithe, that I do. All, you are so lucky to have me. And here the tax collector could not even lift his head to heaven, and he beat his breast, pleading to God for forgiveness, acknowledging his sins. Who was justified? The basis of the biblical rule of worship is a principle called sola scriptura, only Scripture. Only Scripture. We have to be careful not to add to the Word of God or forget or take away from the Word of God. You shall not add to the Word which I am commanding you, nor take away from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord which I command you. No, that is not out of Revelation. That is out of Deuteronomy. Moses, again, telling them to remember the commands that God has given us. It's those thou shall nots, but it's also those thou shall. You will, you won't. Both of well, and then you look, let me move on after that. In 13:32 he says, whatever I command you, you shall be careful to do it. You shall not add to nor take away from it. What do you think God's trying to tell us through Moses? Leave it where it is. I like these guys want to get up and say, well, really what God is saying here. You ever had someone tell you after you hear something, or our news reporters do this to bed, well, what the president really said? Can I tell you, don't insult my intelligence. I'm college educated. I've got two ears. I got eyes. I have that stuff going across the bottom for the hearing impaired. Impaired because I want to know what's being said and make sure I hear it right. And, you know, if you said one thing, then that's what you said. Well, what he really meant was, and more than likely, and no, I'm getting off any president right now. I'm just saying, if someone said it, they probably meant it. And that tells where their heart is at. And we need to be careful when you have pastors get up and say, well, really what the Word of God is saying. No, I will bring, as I did reading Scripture a while ago, like the word manifest, reveal, proclaim, let it be known to you. Only I'm not, I want to make sure that I'm not taking away or adding to the Word of God something that is not there. There is an implied meaning that was there. And all you have to do is listen to me reading the New King James, and you follow in the King James, then you'll see a difference that's there. But the message is the same. And God's message, we have to be so careful that we do not make it mean what it is never intended to mean. And we need to remember when he talks about worship, Jesus said God is seeking people to worship him in big sanctuaries, with keyboards, fog machines, special lights, guitars, keyboards, praise singers in the background, which that is scripturally wrong. Praise singers are out in front. Jill reminded me of this the other day. She said, you remember? The choir went before the armies. Now think about that. When they were going to battle, the choir went before the army, and the army followed. So if you have backup singers in the back, you've already messed up. I don't think that's going to be a condemnable offense. But people want to tell us, well, if you're really going to worship, then you need to. Well, if you're really going to, well, what you're telling me is worship is reduced to music. And what did I say this morning? Worship starts from the moment you walk through that back door, and it goes with you as you leave. It better go with you as you leave out that back door. So, we can worship falsely. We can worship in wrong form. We can worship in self-styled manners. And finally, we can worship the true God with a wrong attitude. A wrong attitude. The most subtle kinds of false worship, more difficult to measure from outward appearance than any other form, is the worship of the true God. The right way, but with the wrong attitude. I got this message and it's all prepared, and man, you guys are going to be blessed to hear me preach it. And that message can be biblical, can be relevant, can be applicable, but if my mind is up here so that I can get the glory, I'm worshiping wrong. I'm worshiping wrong. Same thing goes for singing. Same thing goes for the offering. Same thing goes for the invitation, the benediction, the call to worship, all of that. We can do it the right way, but our attitude, even with the elimination of the false gods, false images, and all the self-style modes of worship, it can still be unacceptable if the heart and attitude is not right. What did Jesus tell that Samaritan woman? God's looking for worshipers. Truth. Truth. We need to make sure that we're right. Coming to church just to make the appearance, because you don't want to have people call and wonder where you're at. Is your attitude right? Is it because you've got this new big 30-pound Bible and you want to carry it to let people know that, hey, I am super Christian? The one that you announce, well, I read through half of the New Testament last night. And that impresses people. If you're here to, if you're being here is to impress people or to gain something from people, our attitude is wrong. If we come in and we're going, wow, God is really lucky I'm here today. I tell you, being a Christian, God is so blessed. You put the emphasis on the wrong syllable and the word comes out funny, doesn't it? And when it's on you, it's not on God, and that's not worship. That's not worship. True worship requires devotion of the whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. Mark and Luke both say that. When it is time to give, we must give the best that we have, not the leftovers of what we've got. The best of what we have, not what's left of what we got. Awe and reverence and focus on truth must fill our mind. Wondering, from the moment we get in, will he go over? How long is this going to be? I've got this show coming on at such and such time. I need to get home and do this. I've got this. When our mind is not engaged in worship, I get it. Listen, I can be boring. I put Jill to sleep. Maybe not preaching, but I put her to sleep. Never when I'm driving. She said, I don't sleep in the car. Well, I think you ought to. That way you won't see death coming at you. It's just like you go to sleep, wake up, and go, whoa. You know, I'm just thinking out loud. But my point is we have to have the right attitude. Listen, Jesus said, if you come to give your gift and you got aught against your brother, lay your gift and go. Take care of it. When you come in and you're on this side of sanctuary, someone's on that side of sanctuary, and you see them and you go, it just kills your spirit. Can I tell you something? Go home. Go home. Because you're not going to get anything out of it, and more than likely people around you are going to sense it. And when I say go home, I'm not saying go home and go fishing. I'm saying go home and get on your knees and figure out what you need to do about this. Or can I tell you better yet? Go get that person and say, hey, will you come with me? I need to talk. Or we need to talk. Or get another person and bring them and say, hey, we need to go talk. Why do you want to worship when your spirit, when your attitude is soured? When your attitude is sour. How do you know when it's time to leave a church? I said, when you come in the doors, and the minute you come in the doors, your spirit is quenched. And when you see that person or a person, persons, a pastor, when you disagree with the leadership of the church, the direction they're going, and what they believe in, and you cannot worship, that's probably a good indication it's time to leave. Confront the ones that are involved in it, and if you have no resolve, God, I believe, is telling you, okay, you can leave. You can leave. And can I tell you something? You're probably causing that with others too. And I think disagreement in the church is one of the worst things that there can be. It kills the spirit when that is there. That's another sermon. True worship. Devotion of the whole heart, mind, soul, strength, awe, and reverence. In Malachi 1, God denounced the people of Israel for inadequacy of their worship. He said in verse 7 of verse chapter 1, "You are presenting food, defiled food, upon my altar." They were treating worship with disdain and flippancy by offering blind, lame, and sick animals. They knew what God required. They just didn't want to give them up. So they brought these animals to him. Instead of bringing the best they had, they were demonstrating contempt for the seriousness of worship. Well, luckily, you don't have to bring your best bull, your best cow. Less now you've got sheep. We're in. You don't have to bring the we don't have to bring those anymore. But may I remind you of something? You are the temple that the Holy Spirit lives in. What kind of shape's your temple in? What's the attitude of your temple? In verse 10, that contempt of worship. In verse 10, God said, "I am not pleased with you, nor will I accept an offering from you." He declined to accept their worship because their attitude was not right. You know, King Uzziah went into the temple. King Uzziah loved the Lord, but King Uzziah was a very proud man. And he thought, "I can go in there and I can give that sacrifice." And they pleaded with him, "Do not go in there. Do not go in there." And the king went in carrying the censer of fire and incense, and he became leprous. And do you know what happened? They couldn't get him out of there fast enough. Why? He not only defiled himself, he just defiled the temple and probably the holy place. He could go in the temple, but he could not go in the holy place. And he broke out in leprosy, which means they had to go in and cleanse the holy place and themselves. And the king was a leper for the rest of his days. His son, Jotham, I believe, was co-regent with him. When King Saul took it upon himself to sacrifice so that no more of the army would leave, he took it upon himself to do something that was not his. He was worshiping with the right intent. Yes, they had to give the sacrifice, but only Samuel was to give it. And he tried to go in and be Samuel. Nadab and Abihu, those men, I believe, were as serious as can be. And their heart was right. And you know, they were doing what they were told to do, but they did it at the wrong time and they did it their way. King James says they brought a strange fire in. Where they got that fire from, I'm not sure. But I know it wasn't where it was supposed to be, when it was supposed to be, how it was supposed to be. Their attitude was wrong. Now, these were the leaders. I get it. But even we can make that mistake today. Can I give you a New Testament example, since all I've done is pull Old Testament? Ananias and Sapphira. They gave a buku to the church. Make no mistake about it. It was a sizable amount. And it was worthy. But what was unworthy about it? You know, they could have said, "We sold this land for this much, and we want to give this much of it to the church." But they wanted to mislead the people and make them think they gave it all to the church. Their attitude was wrong. And let us be careful, for when we come in, that our attitude is wrong. Right. Amos said in chapter 5, verse 21 and following, I reject your festivals. Wow, that's pretty harsh. Now, I want you to think about Amos. This is during the time of both northern and southern kingdom. And this isn't the height of their idolatry and their hypocrisy, but this is moving to it. He said, I hate and reject your festivals, nor do I delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer up to me burnt offerings and your grain offerings, I won't accept them. And I will not even look at the peace offerings of your fatlings. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not even listen to the sound of your harps, but let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing system. What was missing? Justice and righteousness were missing. Their attitude was wrong. Hosea, contemporary with Amos, Hosea said, what shall I do with you, O Ephraim? What shall I do with you, O Judah? For your loyalty is like a morning cloud and like the dew which goes away early. Therefore I have hewn them in pieces by the prophets. I have slain them by the words of my mouth. And my judgments on you are like light that goes forth. For I delight in loyalty rather than sacrifice, and in the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. Their attitude was wrong. Isaiah, he says, what are your multiplied sacrifices to me, says the Lord? I've had enough of burnt offerings of rams and fat of fed cattle. I do not take pleasure in the blood of bulls, lambs, or goats. When you come to appear before me, who requires you this trampling in my courts? Think about that. They're coming to church, and he's saying, you're trampling my courts. I'm not going to respect your offering. None of that. Who requires of you this trampling in my courts? Bring your worthless offerings no longer. Incense is an abomination. New moon and Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies. I cannot endure iniquity and solemn assembly. I hate your new moon festivals, your appointed feasts. They have become a burden to me. I am so weary of bearing them. So when you spread out your hands in prayer, I'll hide my eyes from you. Yes, even though you multiply your prayers, I will not listen. Wow. You think about those words. They were doing the right things, but their attitude was wrong. With Isaiah, Amos, Hosea, there was a syncretic religion. They were blending Baal, Ashtoreth, Chemosh. They were blending together. They'd go in the morning and worship in the temple, and in the afternoon or evening, they'd be under the tree. They would be in the high places. They would be worshiping the other gods that were there. But hey, they were believers. They believed in God, and they just believed in this also. So you're mixing a wrong, you're mixing false attitude or false gods, and you're worshiping with the wrong attitude, thinking, I'll cover all my bases. I'll worship God over here because, and hey, these guys over here, they worship Baal, and that's a fertility god, and they had a pretty good harvest last year. And God just gets to the point, and he says, no. I'll plug my ears. I won't accept your offerings. I will not hear your prayers. I will hide my eyes. You know, you're coming in as just trampling my courts. Let it never be said of us in the church that we're in today that our coming in is the trampling of the carpet just to spend our time in vain, not worshiping, not knowing, not giving our whole allegiance to God. Now, maybe that leaves a question within you, then how do we do it? What does worship mean? What is worship as God designed it to be? Well, we'll find out next Sunday. Let's pray. Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you. Thank you for your word, God. And may we never prostitute it. May we never sell you short by selling ourselves short. When we come into this building, may we come in with a sacrifice of praise. May we be able to lift our hands and our hands only to you. And Lord, may we pray that our heart and mind are in line with what you want it to be, that we do not miss the blessing of being in your presence. Be with us as we leave tonight. Be with us this week, and let us worship you in spirit and in truth. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Bless you.